Now I'm really deeply honored to introduce Professor Idan Segev. I want to tell you a very short story. When I was a student at the medical school in Edessa, we had this course of introduction to psychiatry. We had psychiatrists after psychiatrists coming to us talking about schizophrenia, depression, bipolarism. And then they say one day, we have a special guest today, Professor Idan Segev. And then he showed up and started talking to us, medicine students, about transforming the brain into a computer, or looking at the brain as it were a computer. We were absolutely stunned. We didn't know what to do with that, but it was really was a great inspiration for me and for many in my group that decided to go into research because of that seminal lecture. And after that, I heard many of his lectures in many courses and conferences, and he's really one of the leaders in his field. He is a professor of computational neuroscience. He's both a mathematician and a neurobiologist. He is the former director of the Interdisciplinary Center for Neural Computation at the Hebrew University. He has published papers in journals such as Science and Nature and the PNAS. And the topic of his lecture today will be the Blue Brain Project.
I'm happy to influence people. I hope to the positive. Can we get the turn on the front light somehow? This is back, this is front. Now you can leave the back open and the front closed. Okay, so first of all, welcome. I just came from a very, I think, delightful meeting with some of you. Discussing some other aspects, mostly the ethical brain, issues that have to do with ethics, which is really an emerging field. I wish we had more time to discuss it because I think that all of us, all of you, should consider the issue of where do we want to go with science in general and in particular brain research, because we feel that we is our brain, and because our brain could be manipulated, and could be, should be cured, the link between manipulation and curing is very delicate, very delicate. And so these issues are very fundamental to the society in the 21st century, meaning you. Many of you, I'm sure, will be brain researcher. You understand that we must understand our brain, not only to cure it, but also to make it less aggressive. Apparently we are rather aggressive creatures. With this brain we can do terrible things, we can bomb ourselves, but we can also do beautiful things like finding the Higgs boson and other things and trying to understand our own brain. So today I want to focus about the beauty of this megalomaniac attempt of the brain to understand itself through science. Not through mystics, not through psychology, which are other means to understand things, but through science. So I'll try to be brief, hoping that you will not only be attentive, but also ask questions, because eventually I came here really to interact with you. So let me remind you that in your skull, there is this 200 million years old brain of the mammalians. So rats, mouse, smaller mammals, bigger mammals like cats, monkeys, and us, we are 200 million old as a mammalian species in general. We developed quite a big tissue here, very big. You know that you have below your skull something like 1.4, 1.3, some bigger, some smaller. I just mentioned this morning that Einstein, the great genius probably of all times in physics, had a very small brain, 1.2 kilograms. There are some Nobel laureates with 1.1 kilogram, but the average person, the average woman and man have 1.3, 1.4, and it is not this weight that makes us so unique. It is something else that we don't completely understand, But we are very similar to many other animals, and I'm sure you know that our closest ancestor, the closest ancestor genetically, is the chimpanzee. So if you look at the genome of the chimpanzees, and you compare the sequences of the bases of the genome, of the DNA, between chimpanzees to humans, you see a very small, in a very particular places, very important places apparently, that makes this huge jump, both in the brain, but also of course in the arms, and in our vocal capability and other things. But this is very, very similar to us. So we are part of an evolutionary tree. This is our close father. Some people do not like to feel that their father is chimpanzee. I'm actually very proud to be a member of the chimpanzee family. Why not? They know to jump the trees very well, and they gave us a lot of good genes. But eventually there was this jump. And these jumps enable our brain to be unique in one particular, very special way. And this is the fact that we create. We create new things all the time. We create machines, we create cars, we create computers, we create mathematics, we create art. We are unique in that sense. We create music, as you heard just now, and so forth. What is this creativity? What is the origin of this creativity within this particular brain? What makes us so creative? And this creativity, of course, enables us to become megalomaniac and try to understand ourselves, including the genome of ourselves, the basis of everything. We decipher the code of the human code, the genetic code, and this is an amazing phenomena of a species. This species, you are going to experience a world that is going to be very different than this world. You are going to create a new world, very, very cybernetic kind, very, very cyborg type world, very informatic based world. Who knows where it is going to be? But it is your brain, our brain, that is going to do it, which is amazing and fantastic. And so if you look at this 100,000 years ago, something in this period, so this is time, these are years, and around this time, something like 120,000 years ago, there is this new phenomena that called the Homo sapiens. Here we stand, a very young generation of a species, did not exist before in Europe and then all over the world, in Africa and all over the world. Suddenly here, there was an emergence of big brain, specifically big brain, by the way, which is going to go down. As you can see, our brain is shrinking. So we have smaller brain than about 10,000 years ago. We can discuss what happened to our brain that becomes smaller but still smarter in many ways. But anyway, during this yellow period, which is called the cultural revolution, there are no genetic changes. It's the same species. We are not different than the person that was living 100,000 years ago, maybe in the prehistoric caves in south of France, or in Russia, or in Africa. It's the same species with of course individual differences, but the genome is the same genome. So we can speak about the Homo sapiens as a whole, as one species that now completely, totally controls the world. You know that there were other human species, other type of species that are also from the Homo time. The Neanderthals lived together with us for some time. Some even claim that we have some genes from the Neanderthals, but after all, at some point, maybe 3,000 years ago, we became the only species of the Homo type living in the world, the Homo sapiens. And this Homo sapiens is generating amazing things, absolutely amazing, like inviting you from Asia to come to Jerusalem, sharing science, sharing art. Amazing. If you think about this, it's really absolutely fantastic, a phenomenon. And very, very recent. So this art, which I highly recommend if you didn't see it yet, look at the prehistoric art in the caves of south of France and north of Spain. Absolutely amazing creation of the human brain. Later on, some 5,000 years ago, we started to write. Suddenly there are this symbolic language. So I write A, B, A, and it's Abba in Hebrew, or it's Father in English, and so forth, just creating symbols and agreement between us. This is a very new phenomenon. Not because there is a new gene, just because somebody invented an idea and we all adopted it very fast. Science is very new, the modern science. 3,000 years ago, the Greek and Egypt started to do systematic science, mathematics and so forth. Computer is very young, maybe 60, 70, 50 years old, depending how you count, but it's a whole new machine. It's a very new machine, not to speak about iPhones and so forth. And eventually there is this attempt today to understand the brain in the most fundamental mathematical, physical basis. And that's what I want to discuss with you, one possible direction to understand the brain using modern scientific tools, and especially computers. But before that, I want to mention some megalomaniac, dramatic, absolutely dramatic projects that are now going on, not necessarily about the brain, but just to show you how megalomaniac we are, trying to really do absolutely amazing things. And this is the following. So I don't know if you know, but the European Commission in Europe, they decided to call for projects, they call it the flagship projects. They send a call to Europe to propose projects in any field. It could be physics, it could be economics, it could be earth technology, anything they want. And eventually there were 19 calls like this. Six climbed, these are the six that climbed to the final call, to the final stage. And in October, this October, so it's 2 months from today or less, we are going to apply, the all six projects are going to apply to Europe. And eventually in February 2013, two of these six will get 1 billion euro each for this project. It's a 10 years project. We are part of it, the Human Brain Project. I'll discuss this today. But just to give a perspective, I want to tell you about some other projects that are also competing with us. And as you can see, we have 33% success rate, hopefully, because we are third. Two will be winning out of these six. And for example, let me give you this project. For example, the Robocom. The Robocom is an Italian project. This Robocom, and you know that Japan are also very good in robots, and not only Japan, but some other countries. But this Robocom project from Italy claims the following, that if he will get 1 billion euro, if you give this group, which is a big group, not only in Italy, but in Europe, if you'll give them 1 billion euro, they can promise that within 10 years, they will generate a compassionate robot. Compassionate robot. This compassionate robot will take care of old people at home. It will bring food to the old person. It will change the bed, take him to the toilet. Now, many people do not like the idea, of course, at all. Why should robot take care of me? But since we are all robots, yes, in many ways, and as I said before, I consider myself to be a physical robot, a human physical robot, but still a physical entity, why should we not build somebody that may be able even to do it maybe better than we do? That's a question. But he promised, this Dario from Italy, promised that he can generate a robot that will do all that is needed at a given home, including learning, because each home is different and each person has different needs. There will be a period of teaching the robot, and then the robot will take care of you. And it will be fantastic, it will be compassionate. You may even fall in love with a robot, who knows. So that's one project, and there is it's very likely that you will win. They are very good in their in this project. They are also doing very good work in public relationship. The other project I want to mention is this Guardian Angels. So the Guardian Angels, which is a British project, they claim that this world, and you know that they are right, is going to be a world of sensors, full of sensors. It will sense everything. There will be a sensor, a GPS. There will be a sensor for the atmosphere. There will be a sensor for the blood pressure inside. You will swallow sensors. They will generate information about your blood pressure, about the sucrose level, about heart attack, possible heart attack. Everything will be sensed. There will be sensors, thousands and millions of sensors distributed all over the world, but what to do with all this information? what to do with all this information. It will be a chaotic information if there will be no systematic way to use this information in order to predict the next storm, the next heart attack, the next accident. So it is going to be a world of sensors, that's true, and they decide to give a very nice database analysis, informatic way to deal with all these sensors and make sense of them so that eventually you can really predict things in advance and avoid accidents and avoid heart attack and so on. So these are two of the three of the six. This is the Grapheme. You know, Grapheme is a Nobel Prize physicist, Russian physicist, who is now in England, and they want to develop this nanotechnological atomic scale wires, very small wires and so on. These are very, very interesting, just to show you that human beings are getting into the 21st century with a very megalomaniac approach to try to basically solve everything. Prolong life, solve the issue of diseases, or predict diseases in advance, take care of older people, and we, the Human Brain Project, are trying to understand the brain. So let me now focus, dwell into this Human Brain Project. So this project started actually with a colleague of mine who is now in Lausanne, Henry Markram. So if you log into the computer, you will see many million of entry into the Henry Markram Lausanne School. So he is at the EPFL in Lausanne. That's where they have this big computer, this IBM Blue Gene computer. The Blue Gene computer is the computer that, you know, succeeded to beat Kasparov in a chess competition, and this is the computer, an older version, that succeeded to break, so to speak, the human code, the genome code, and we are using the same computer in Lausanne to try to reverse engineer, to simulate in details, the human brain. So I want to show you how we are going to do it step by step. Of course, we are just in the middle, but there are some nice beginnings, and we are more and more optimistic that eventually we will have sufficiently strong computers to be able to really completely replicate a whole brain in action. Why do we want to do it? We can discuss. But one thing is that we feel that if you build a model of anything, it could be a model of the heart or the kidney or a model of anything you want, then you understand. Without building a model, it's not complete understanding. It's a claim, no, but not everybody agrees with this claim. Of course, you don't want to build a model of the universe, a replica of the universe, in order to understand it. There are other ways to understand things, but building or simulating is one important thing, and that's what we are going to do. So it's a group of many people. Today there are about 300 scientists in Spain, in Belgium, in England, and we in Israel, and Markram and his group in Lausanne, together proposing the following Blue Brain Project. Again, the blue comes from this machine. IBM used to be blue, now it's black. So Blue Gene is the blue IBM machine. We are using blue, but we are now using the blue brain because we want to understand the brain. Also, of course, the association of the blue brain, which is a good association because it has to do with some sexual attraction, it's also part of our brain, yes? We are also sexual entities. So Blue Brain is a nice name, and I'm sure that now, as I speak, you will never forget the term Blue Brain. So I succeeded to control your brain by implanting a term, the Blue Brain Project. So what do we want to do? So I want to give you an example of a success of simulation. Or a reverse engineering. You are trying to build in the computer, step by step, mathematically, you are trying to build each process involved in what you are trying to understand. This is just an example, a very dramatic example, of a case several years ago of the terrible case of the Columbia shuttle, space shuttle. I'm sure many of you have heard about this, especially of Israelis, because we have had here a very loved, beloved astronaut who died in this accident. So this is the last seconds of the shuttle. So it goes into the atmosphere, And at some point, unexpectedly, as he entered the atmosphere, it suddenly, unexpectedly, blew up. That's it. Just blew up. Nobody expected it. It was already arriving to Earth. We don't understand. We didn't understand what happened there. And so the issue is what to do. I want to understand how come that this shuttle just suddenly blew up. What can we do? So what was done, and that's, I think, a very interesting lesson about human being trying to understand the phenomena, is the following. So NASA, sorry that you don't see here below, NASA, the American space agent, NASA, decided to dedicate a huge computer, to this simulation of this shuttle. What they did is they simulated the shuttle in the computer, uses a lot of processors. This was a silicon graphics machine. They simulated everything that could simulate mathematically. They simulated the wind flow. They simulated the pressure of atmosphere based on what is understood in physics about pressure, about wind. They simulate the wings, structure, and so forth. So they try to simulate as much as they can do in the computer a replica, a copy of the space shuttle. Because they could not build another space shuttle to send it to the moon or to send it outside, and then when it comes back, it blows again. This is not an understanding, yes? They are trying to do a replica in the computer of the item they want to understand, and that's what they found in the simulation, in the computer. Notice here, this little point here. So I got this from the NASA people. They sent me these pictures just to tell you, to show you what did they find. So they found here, you see this little piece? This is about 20 centimeter piece of ice. Here. Coming off of this region, hitting the space shuttle here, and the prediction of the model, and that's the interesting thing, the prediction of the model was that this 20 centimeter ice piece of ice should generate a crack in this region, and then temperature got in, and this is the source of the strategy. This is the source of the blow up of the machine. So this is a simulation of a phenomena using a computer based on all that you know about this environment. But people in America were not very happy. They said, just a second, okay, simulation and all that, but how can we be sure? And the question is, what does it mean to be sure? Yes, when are you sure that something happened? Eventually, they built physically a model of this, physically, they built a model of this shuttle. They shoot from here 20 centimeters ice piece. They hit this region, there was a crack, and everybody felt that they understood what happened. So this is what is called reverse engineering by simulation or simulation-based research. You use a computer and the mathematical formulation of each process you're interested in order to replicate what you want to study. Then you can do manipulation in your computer, try to understand the whole process. And that's exactly what we are trying to understand with the brain. So the brain is a machine. As I said, I'm a robot. I'm a physical robot. I'm built from nerve cells, from membrane, from spikes, from electrical activity, from chemical activity. These are all processes that I should be able, if I understand them, to simulate mathematically, each process separately. Then I need to build the machine, because this machine is built from networks of neurons. So here I just show you a little piece from a cortex of a mammalian, human, mouse, and so forth, very similar. You take a cubic millimeter here from a little piece of your cortex, and you can see something on the order of between 10 to 50,000 cells. Here are the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so forth, 50,000 or 10,000 cells. Each one is connected to others via these synapses, and each one of these cells is generating this electrical activity. So I should be able, in principle, to simulate the electrical activity of this piece of brain. And if I succeed to simulate this electrical activity, I should be able, if I have enough computers, I can simulate the whole brain. This will mean that I replicated, I reverse engineered, step by step, all the processes involved, including chemicals, including blood flow, including other cell types, including everything. If I succeed to do it, and indeed, that's what all that we have in the brain, then this machine, so to speak, or this simulation, when it interacts with the environment, and that's very important, of course, because the brain on its own doesn't mean anything until it creates interaction with the environment. It starts to talk, to walk, to speak, to feel. All this needs interaction with the environment, so I need to close the loop. But if I build such a machine, and it should interact with the environment and be able to plastically change, that's of course very important, because our machine, the computer, is static. And this machine is plastic. It is changing physically. It generates new connections. It changes the properties of the electrical activity. If we understand also the rules, mathematical rules, that underlie changes in the brain, then I should be able to generate a machine that will come to hear my lecture, or maybe a machine that gives the lecture, because as I said, I'm already a machine that gives the lecture. The only question is, can I build another one? So of course I can build another one, because I can make children. But these children, I don't understand them. Because this building of children doesn't mean that I went through the slow process, step by step, of looking at each process and simulating it mathematically. So we believe, as a species, that this mathematical, that mathematical tools are the, really the fundamental tools to understand any physical phenomena, including the brain. So that's the philosophy behind the Blue Brain Project. So let me go further and tell you what else. Luckily, in the last several years, we are getting fantastic, absolutely shocking, even for me, being a scientist for many years, new technologies that enable us to very rapidly reconstruct the anatomy of the brain. Okay, the brain is built from 10 to the power of 11 nerve cells, 100 billion cells, or 100 milliard cells, huge amount of cells. Each one is connected to about 10,000 others. How do we study the anatomy of a brain, of a mouse, let's say? So there is this new technology, which is absolutely fantastic technology. It's called the brain bow technology. I hope you will not forget this brain bow technology, first of all, because it's a nice name. Not rainbow, but brain bow. Not only nice name, but also it generates beautiful pictures. Now, what is these pictures? You can genetically manipulate the genome of a mouse. You can place a piece of DNA that, when expressed, generates a particular protein with a particular fluorescent property. So I can stain genetically brains of mouse, and when they are born, this mouse, they have this brain. It's not only, it's not anymore gray brain or black brain. It's a colorful brain. It is called the rainbow brain. So we have in our lab here mouse with brains that, when you look at them, they are glowing with beautiful colors, psychedelic colors, all over, yellow, green, red, anything you want. About 260 different colors in a brain of this mouse. The nice thing is, of course, because it is in the genome coded, also the next generation will have a brain bow. So it will always be a colorful brain. This is very helpful because this brain bone technology enables us to really do a new kind of anatomy. Because rather than having a jungle of cells, each one is dark or gray, you have now a jungle of very colorful, very beautiful brains, and you can say, ah, you know, this green cell is connected to the blue cell, and this purple cell is connected to this red cell. It makes anatomy much, much more, not only beautiful, but much more practical. So this is one technology, the brain bow. The other technology that just came out, this is called the connectomics approach. In order to really see which cell is connected physically to another cell by synapse, you need to do it at the electron microscope level. You cannot look at it with a regular optical light microscope and see the connection. You can see the cells, but not the connection. In order to see the connection, you have to cut the brain to very, very, very fine details and then use computer vision to reconstruct a piece of a brain. So I want to show you here a piece of a brain of a mouse, a very small piece of the mouse cortex, reconstructed with EM electron microscope slices, and then using computer vision, you can see which cell is connected to C. This is called connectomics. So you see, you cut, you build three-dimensional reconstruction of this jungle of cells. This is a very small piece, yes? And when you have this, you can stain the cells. This is an EM, so you stain the cells in fake colors, let's say with Photoshop, and then you detect location of connection, and this is the jungle in your brain. This is a synapse here. This is another synapse there. So I can now see the connection. So look at your brain now. This is mouse. Your brain looks similar. How complicated this piece of a brain is. But we are getting into this technology that enables us to recon. You can see blood vessels are going through here. This is blood vessel through your brain. So we can do it today. Still, we need an advanced technology. This was done in MIT, as you can see, a very strong group. And if you go to TED, I'm sure you heard about the TED lecture series, and you look at Sebastian Song, who is a mathematician, physicist in MIT, who is doing the leader of connectomics. He already also wrote a beautiful book called Connectomics. If you read his book, and you will see the TED lecture, he starts by saying, I am my connectomics. I'm not my genome. I'm my connectomics. What makes me Sebastian, what makes me Idan, what makes somebody else, is the connections in the brain. I am my connectomics. He calls, and all the audience, like in TED, respond, I am my connectomics. So everybody become believer of connectomics. So it's a very nice lecture in TED, which I recommend, but especially his book is very good, Connectomics. Okay, so suppose I have all the anatomy. Suppose I give you all the connections and all the cells with all these technologies, I still miss something important. I miss the electrical activity. So on this basis of anatomy, there are these electrical signals, which are called spikes, that every cell in the universe, every nerve cell in the universe generates. The spiking properties of the cell. So this little blip, this little signal is called spike or action potential. It's a little signal that the cell generates. Its height is about 0.1 volt, 100 millivolts, the amplitude. The duration is a 1 millisecond, a thousandth of a second. So it appears and disappears, and then another one appears and disappears. You can see it's a very significant repetitive bit of information. So this is how cells talk to the world. This is how cell represents something in the world. So when you hear a music, when you hear my voice, when you see a movie, a group of cells generate this kind of activity, and a collective activity, a symphony of electrical activity, represents something in the world. So if you hear a music, and you know, this is Bizet, the composer, you know that this is the composer because in a given group of cells, you have this particular activity, electrical activity, with a particular music. So this cell is doing ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, and this cell is doing ta-ra-ta-ta-ta-ta, and this cell is doing trut-stop, trut-stop, trut-stop. And all this ta-ta-ta-ta-ta is electrical activity built from spikes. So it's like a barcode. It's a barcode, but in this case, the barcode, the width of the bar is constant. It's a 1 millisecond width. And the height of the code is also constant. And the difference is just the pattern in time. How is the pattern in time built? So you can see that you have a lot of instruments, electrical instruments, but eventually the music is what you feel, is what you see, is what you plan. There is nothing else in the brain beside this electrical code and the underlying chemical mechanisms, ion flows, potassium and sodium and so on, that generates this kind of activity. And the connection between one cell to the other, which is a transformation of electrical activity in one cell via a chemical transmitter to the electrical activity in the other cell. And as I said, each cell type has a different kind of profile of activity. These cells like to fire and stop. This cell fire, and then fire slowlier. And this is what we need to model mathematically. Not only to know the anatomy, but also mathematically to model these cells, and also to model the connection, the synapse, between one cell to another cell. This connection, this chemical connection, which carries the transmitter, the receptors, and so forth, this chemical connection can also be mathematically be described in a certain set of equations. Just to give you an example of a set of equations, so if you want to simulate mathematically the voltage change when the cell is firing, so this is voltage, and this is the differential equation that describe the spike. This is Nobel Prize from Hodgkin and Huxley in 1952. So this is Hodgkin-Huxley equations that describe the single spike. We need to expand it, and that's what I do with my group, expand this set of equations to describe a set of spikes, not a single one, but a set of spikes with a particular pattern, as I mentioned before. So it should be either this set of spikes or this set of spikes or this set of spikes, but we have a model of the individual spike. We are now developing and actually finished modeling any particular profile of spikes. We know to do it mathematically. So we do this, we do that, and we get mathematically, you can see how good is our mathematical fit. So this is experiments, the brown color, and this is the model, the yellow color. You can see that we can replicate mathematically any firing pattern of any cell in the brain of any animal using mathematical equations. So we finished with this project now. We have other things to do, as I said. We have to model the connections, the mathematical synapses. We already finished to model the mathematical synapses mathematically. We have to model learning, because as I said, and that's the most important aspect of the brain, it is not a static machine, because you have to learn something new as I speak. So this means that the synapses, the strength of the connection, and also new synapses are being born now. When I talk to you, there are new synapses, new connections being born now. It's called brain plasticity. Can we model learning mathematically? Yes, there is a whole trend. I'm sure you heard about what is called machine learning. It's a whole field in computer science, machine learning. And also in physics, many physicists, great physicists from Japan, from America, from Israel, are now developing theory of learning, because this is something that you have to embed into your model in order to do theory. And then eventually, learning. And eventually, of course, you want to connect everything, and that's exactly what we do. So we take the Blue Brain computer from Israel. So in my lab, there is a very fast line, very broadband line directly to Lausanne, because the computer is there, but of course you don't care whether it's a computer as long as you can use it. And you put into the computer, cell by cell, mathematically. So each cell is represented as a mathematical entity in one microchip. We have now more than close to 100,000 microchips. You can now simulate, really connect in the computer, cell A to cell B, cell B to cell C, with the correct mathematical description of the synapse, with the correct mathematical description of the spikes. So in principle, you already have everything you want, just to show you how it looks. So this is a simulation of a single cell. It's a real, totally reconstructed and mathematically represented a single cell with all the synapses and spines and connections. So you can generate beautiful movies from this machine, of course. And you can also simulate mathematically a whole network. So this is a simulation of a cubic millimeter that I mentioned before. It is called the cortical column. It's about 10,000 cells. You can see the jungle, but now this jungle is in the computer, represented mathematically. all the connections, all the cables, all the axons, all the dendrites, all the synapses. This is how you look in the computer. So that's where we are, basically. We are now building piece by piece. We now succeeded already to simulate a larger part of the brain. This is, by the way, all the connections. So these are the red synapses and the blue synapses are the excitatory synapses and the inhibitory synapses. There are two types of synapses in the brain. This is all the simulated synapses in this piece that I showed you before. We have a billion synapses in this piece, and all these billion synapses are part of the simulation. So all the connections are there, and the inhibitory synapses and the excitatory synapses are all sitting there waiting for an input. Should I put a face to these neurons? Should I put a line? Should I put a bottle and see what happens? And we are starting to do this today. We can see the activity. So this is the electrical activity. So this cell now fired, it became red. This cell now fired, and it transmitted information to another cell. You can start to see the dynamics, the activity in this network as it goes on. Does it feel anything, this network? Probably not, because it didn't learn to feel fear, it didn't learn to feel love, but it will, if I connect it correctly to this, to the environment, and if I know how to plastically change it in order to react correctly to the environment. So this is what we are doing at that point. We are really simulating a piece of a cubic millimeter in the computer, giving it certain inputs, trying to see how the signal propagates. This is one column, this is one cubic millimeter. We already succeeded to simulate about 20 columns, and this is the limitation of the computer today, and some limitation of the anatomy that is still not known, because you can see that there are these connections between areas, and not all the connections are still known, but it's coming. It's only a matter of time that the connectomics will bring me the connections, and if I have the connections, I can simulate them because I have the correct mathematics. We don't completely understand learning. Certainly, we don't understand why one person learns better than another. So what are the differences between individuals? But what we are doing now, and I think it's very important, is trying to understand diseases. So you know, unfortunately, that as we get older, we see more and more diseases, neurological diseases, neuropsychiatric diseases, like Parkinson, and like Alzheimer, and like schizophrenia, and like autism, and like sleep disorders, and many, many, many diseases. Unfortunately, we have today 560 marked diseases of the brain. And these diseases are becoming more frequent as you become older. And we must, as a society, and that's what I started to say, we must solve the brain problem if we want to solve these diseases, especially if we like to live longer, because they will emerge more and more. So what can we do? What can we do is what we are trying now to do with Henry Markham. I'm just going in 2 weeks to Lausanne to exactly do that. We can take pieces of a brain of a sick mouse. We have mouse that are sick with depression. We have depressed mouse. We have mouse that are sick with autism. We have autistic mouse. We have mouse that are sick with epilepsy. So we are now modeling a piece of a brain that we know that is somehow responsible for the disease. And we are trying to simulate a piece of a brain of a diseased mouse, let's say autistic mouse, and compare it to the brain of a, so to speak, normal mouse that is not autistic. Where do we see the changes? Mathematically, is it certain type of synapses? Is it certain type of spiking activity? Is it the flow of information within the network that is dynamically incorrect in some sense? I think we shall have a model of the disease in the computer. The computer will become sick of the disease. Then I have a handle, then I have a direct handle on parameters. I can change the synapse, I can change the activity, I can really manipulate in the computer and cure the computer, so to speak. Then I think we can go back to the disease. Because you know, unfortunately, all the neurological disease, without exception, we don't understand them. We don't really understand why in Parkinson suddenly a group of cells starts to fire with burst, ta-ta, stop, ta-ta, stop. Why? Why? And why suddenly a person stopped to sleep well? What is this insomnia? What is suddenly a person have this epilepsy? Why does it start? What is the source of it? We don't understand it, but we give some, of course, medication, which do help, but without understanding. And when I speak about understanding, I mean building a model of the disease, building a model of the brain, building a model of the heart. Only then I can say that I understand. And I want to finish by an optimistic note. Again, some people are very much against this project because, you are trying to replicate ourselves, you want to replace yourself, you think that you are God. I don't want to think of myself as a robot. I don't want to think of myself as a physical entity. All this is fine, but it's not science. Science is not talking about what you feel or not feel. Science is trying to understand a phenomenon. This is a phenomenon. My feeling is a physical phenomenon. My coming here to talk to you, your travel from Asia here is a phenomenon I need to understand, especially if there is sickness. So we are here. We hope, look, if we get the billion, if you give me the $1 billion, the €1 billion, which is better, yes? If you give me the €1 billion, when I say we, me, I mean these 300 scientists all over Europe, we believe that in about 20 years or less, we will have a complete model of the human brain in a computer, solving diseases, understanding aggression, understanding ourselves. Thank you very much. Questions?
Suppose that we can build two blue brain projects, okay?
Two blue brain, okay. You see, you are very ambitious. We didn't finish one, you already want two. Good.
Suppose that we can build two. Are the two computers have the same intelligence? Because of our brain are the same, but we have not the same intelligence or IQ. Thank you.
Okay, so that's a good question. It's a question about individuality. So I take two computers that are totally identical to start with. Same network, the same synapses, the same spikes, absolutely a copy of each other. Two blueprint projects. And you ask me a fair question, are they going to be similar? And the answer is absolutely not. Why? Because one blue brain computer will go to the right and you will see the piano. The other blue brain project will look to the left and you will see him. That's on its own create different brains. Just that. This computer has a different father, so I will hug him like this. And this another computer will have a different mother and she will hug him like this. And this creates a different creature. So that's exactly what I wanted to highlight. First of all, the environment has an enormous effect on the computer, on this computer, the environment. Of course, and that's a second answer, we are not born similar. You have blue eyes, I have black eyes, and so on. There are genetic differences, which also dictates, to a certain degree, the output of this machine. So the two blue machines, if I copy them, are not really a representation of the human condition or human beings because they are not born the same. Even identical twins have differences, not in the genome, but in the epiphenomena aspects. So we are not born the same. But I'm saying that even if we were born the same, two amoeba, you take two amoeba that are identical amoeba, you put one to the right and one to the left, there is this chemical here, there is another chemical there, they are different amoeba. They are not going to be the same, just because of the interaction with the environment, which is so critical to this creature, any living creature. The definition of life in many ways is this loop with the environment. And my computer, this fantastic Macintosh, is a very stupid machine because it doesn't change. I give this lecture 10 times and it remains the same lecture. What is this? We are not the same.
Thank you. us that you simulate the brain and with so many neurons, synapses, and I think you will create a large amount of information. Will it be too much to understand on a general level, because we may want to know more about the structure of our process of perception, cultures, or learning, something like that?
That's a beautiful question. I agree with you completely. This is only one way to understand something. And this is the replication, mathematical replication, of a complex network, a complex system with billions of cells and billions of synapses and so forth. You are looking for a different level of understanding, which of course is part of brain research, and this is what is actually called computational or theoretical neuroscience, because you want to understand principles. For example, principles of perception or principles of movement. Some higher level theory that doesn't come what we call bottom up, not from the details, but to come from up, from top down, and understand principles, which is also part of brain research. We have very powerful physicists also in Jerusalem, like Chaim Sompolinsky, one of our great physicists who are coming from physics. And physics learn that there are certain regularities in the world. You know, you want to speak about pressure, but you don't need to know every molecule or atom where it is. So you can understand a phenomena conceptually, mathematically, at a higher level of description. If that's what you are looking for, absolutely it should go with this kind of description, because you are right that in some cases the complexity of the model will be more complex or as complex as myself, and I may not be able to understand the model itself. I need to have concepts. And these concepts come mostly from physicists who are coming to the field with great theories, mean field, dynamical system, information theory, and they're using these theories to understand this phenomena. So it should go together, bottom up and top down. We should meet somewhere in the center and say, now I understand, at all levels. But we are not there yet. But we are working hard.
The last question, please.
A woman there. You. Yes?
My name is Yasmin.
Sorry?
My name is Yasmin, and I'm from Israel. And my question is that you said that at some extent you can do a robot view. So if we can replace all humans with robots, what's the use of having humans?
This is the fear, you see? This is the fear. Okay, first of all, as I said, I'm not an ethical judge, and the society will have to decide if it wants to create a different species or not. It could help us, as I said, it could help elderly people and save us time, and we can go and listen to Mozart or to Bizet or whatever. It's not instead of us, it could be helping us. It depends on what we do with any invention, with the atom bomb, or with informatics, or with this. I'm just saying my claim is that if we want to extend life, of our own life, via medication, there will be diseases that we must solve. If we must solve these diseases, we cannot continue the way medication is working today, because medication is a trial and error, basically, with some understanding of some principles. And we must build the model of what we try to understand. That means that we build a model of ourselves. By building a model of ourselves, we may use it for a robot or not. This depends on what we decide. I'm not calling to replace myself. I'm calling to a method to understand myself in order to repair. On the other hand, why should we let a random molecular or genetic changes to create a new or not create a new breed like happened 100,000 years ago, suddenly human came out. We can now control what we want. We want a robot friend, we shall create a robot friend. We don't want a robot friend, we will not create a robot friend. We have to decide. It's not instead, it's in addition, and it could be very helpful.
So, you change your plans, you have time for one more question. This would be the last one.
Which one?
that you have Professor Zhou Peijie from China. Okay, I have maybe two little questions. The first is about, is there does a random effect or stochastic effect come to your model that in two different simulations we get total different results? The second one is, I think, there are so many parameters in your there are so many parameters in your model, your mathematical model. So is there a good method to find the right set of parameters? I think it's really a huge job, skills task. Or how can you say that this set of parameters is exact the parameters in reality, the brain works?
Beautiful question. I must say that you are a scientist by now already, yes? Because you ask two difficult questions for a brain researcher. One is this variability. If you look at a single cell, as any biological system, you look at a single cell, you see that this cell, for the same input, behave a little bit different from time to time. There is an intrinsic noise. It's a physical noise. So that means that we are not deterministic machines, as the world is not deterministic, but we are stochastic machines in some sense. The question is, and it's still open, how this local stochasticity at the level of atoms or of ion channels is reflected in the behavior. Okay, that's an open question, because there is a lot of local noise, but it could be averaged out when you have massive of cells. Each one is behaving a little different each time, but on average, they behave the same, and I remain, in some sense, myself. It's an open question, it's a good question. Personally, if you ask me, I think that the fact that the brain, you know, in the computer, they try to calm down noise and make it as less noisy as possible. Our brain is noisy. The synapse is unreliable, the cell is unreliable, everything is unreliable, and eventually I am hopefully somewhat reliable, yes? And I think that part of our creativity, the fact that we are creative, the fact that suddenly a new idea comes to me in this condition, I say, I'm going to the lab to try something new, comes from the fact that I'm a noisy element, that I'm not a deterministic element. So, but this is a belief, I don't know to prove it now. That's one question. The other question, which is even more difficult, is this amount of parameters. So it's a large system. You can describe it at many levels, from atoms, genes, to behavior. Huge amount of parameters. What is the correct set of parameters? It's an open question, but one thing I should tell you, and this is due to our work and among other work, even biology solved the problem, for example, to generate a spike. There are many underlying ion channels parameters that will give you the same phenotype. So the genotype could be different, but the output could be very similar, yes? Also, biology solved it in the same way. There is no one-to-one solution. Okay, so a big set, a cloud of parameters can give you this one solution. And that's what we are doing in our model. We allow the parameters to change within a big parameter space, as long as it's not going outside, then you won't get the solution anymore. And within this shape, one cell pick up this parameter, another cell pick up this parameter, they behave the same, but they are not coming from the same parameter space. Still, there is the problem of the huge parameter space, and that's why these abstract, more simplified models can give you the key parameters. Out of this sea of parameters, what are the key parameters that give the property that you are interested in? And give up, as physicists like to do, give up the less important parameters that are there, but they are not key parameters. That's science. Science is about finding the key parameters. Sorry that I have to finish because you have all these other things, but I enjoyed talking to you. I hope you enjoyed coming here. Let's meet one day again.
Thank you.